And welcome to Kat's Coffee Talks. I'm Kat, and today we have a beautiful artist who does amazing work. I'm so excited to have Katherine Nelson here. And welcome, Katherine. I'm going to read your bio that you sent me, and it's just such a tiny little bit of who you are and what you do, but here we go. So Katherine Nelson is an artist, educator, and juror currently based in DC, Baltimore region. She received a bachelor's in arts education from Skidmore College, New York in 1985, and a master's in arts and drawing from SUNY Albany in 1990. She was born in Holland. Kathy spent 15 years of her childhood living abroad in Holland, Germany, Turkey, and Belgium. We'll be talking about that. After college, she taught art in public school in both New York State and North Carolina for 15 years before moving to Spokane, Washington, which is where I met you with my husband and 1.5-year-old son. And that was a week before 9/11 hit.
Yes.
While living in Spokane, she juggled family, 2 sons under the age of 5, along with art exhibitions in Spokane and Idaho region. Nelson's velvety, linear, and textural charcoal drawings explore meaningful connections through still life, flora, fauna, land, and landscape. While living in Spokane, the focus primarily on the imagery of the Palouse and the, how do you say that? Agrarian?
Agrarian, yeah.
Agrarian landscapes. I'm seeing double here. She created cover art for Inlander magazine, fiction contest, Willow Springs, and the musician Kevin Brown. Kathy has exhibited in numerous solo, juried, and invitational exhibits across the United States and Europe. Katherine earned a permanent teacher's certification in arts education K-12 from New York State and has taught drawing from all levels for the past 25 years. Amazing. I just remember when I first saw your work and I thought, you know, it was like American regionalism, you know, the Grant Wood, the Thomas Hart Benton that I just am a huge fan of. And then when I got to know you as a person, I realized there's so much more to it. And your history with your family and just your connection to the landscape is really quite fascinating. So I'd like you to talk about that a little bit. So welcome. It's good to see you, girl.
Thank you. It's great to see you. And thanks so much for the invite to participate in your new show, because it's a real honor. I'm so glad. I've always admired you as an artist and as a musician. So it's a real honor to be speaking with you today. Well, I think, you know, my landscapes really were influenced by my childhood in a lot of senses, because we were exploring all of the time. My parents were both really curious about getting out into the environment and working with people that they met, and they created this amazing legacy, which is based on bringing a very rare breeder dog from Turkey to the United States. So they modeled this whole way of being and living, where they explored a lot and got to know the people where they were exploring, and something always came out of that. So it was like my philosophy as a arts creator is the artist is an explorer and a teacher. And we do that through sharing our images and through getting down into the nitty gritty, the dirt, and trying to understand those places and those people and what's happening there. So, you know, I've moved around a lot. I've lived in a lot of different places. Turkey was one of the most amazing places I lived as a kid. When I got there, I was in 7th grade. And the first thing I did a week later was, it happened to be quite coincidental, but there was a program going on that was called Sea School. So next thing I know, I'm like a 7th grader and I'm going down the Mediterranean in a thing called Sea School. And it was a partnership between Turkish students and American students. And it was to study the whole Mediterranean coast. So we were gone for about a week and a half. And it was really a phenomenal experience because you're all of a sudden really immersed in another cultural experience and you're seeing places you've never seen before. So that combined with the projects that my parents did over the years, particularly with founding the ADAA, which is the Akbash Dog Association of America, they brought in a rare breed that eventually got noticed by the Agriculture Department and was introduced by Bob Berglund, the Secretary of Agriculture, to the American public. So that model just made me so enthusiastic about exploring and what the results could be from that. So so that's how I sort of modeled my own career as an artist, is to try to explore things and to understand cultural connections and the uniqueness of a landscape and so forth.
So they're very progressive, ahead of their time, really. I mean,
I mean, their project has really left an amazing legacy in helping American ranchers with their, you know, their livestock. So their livestock guard dogs. And then they also brought in the Kongol dogs. And the Kongol dogs are a very rare breed in Turkey as well. And they're actually a national treasure there now. But one of the things that my parents did was when they noticed these dogs, I mean, we had a place outside of Ankara. So we would leave every weekend. Initially, it was for our health. My dad was really concerned about fog and smog and all that stuff and breathing bad air, because most of Ankara at the time in the 70s was heated by coal. And so there was this bowl of smog, and he really wanted to get out and breathe fresh air. So we started going out and exploring, and we were in this Ford Falcon yellow wagon, a station wagon, an American family, you know, going across, you know, central Anatolia. And we went down this dirt road, and oh my goodness, my dad immediately saw these dogs guarding the sheep, the Akbash, and he became extremely curious about it. So So we would go for the weekends there. We rented a place there, and we would come in and we would have our mummy bags, and it was like a mud and straw hut. And we would meet a lot of the farmers in the area and the ranchers. And we were invited in to have tea and food around the tepsi. And it was a really unusual experience. So, I mean, there was a hole in the ground for the toilet in our little home. There was a wood stove in there. And I actually had my very first introduction to sourdough bread when we would stop in Eskişehir, which was a very small town at that time. And we would pick up our bread for the weekend. And we would put like 6 or 7 loaves in the car. And it would smell like a bakery in there. And it was incredible. And then we hit the road, and we go over these dirt paths and all over the countryside. And literally the countryside was, I would say, covered with archaeological findings, bits and pieces of all kinds of places. And we'd go from one village to another and meet one person after another. And they would say, oh yeah, yeah, so-and-so had some dogs and so forth. So eventually, when our whole assignment in Turkey concluded, we came back with one Akbash dog who was preparing to have puppies within, you know, several months. And that was our first introduction to bringing the Akbash dog to the United States. So that was in the 70s. And so, you know, that project just grew and grew. So that's kind of, that model really kind of motivated me as a creator to see what the possibilities were. And then there was also the side of my dad that was, he was very creative. So in all of those places that we went, we were constantly going to museums, museum education. You know, I was born in Holland. So, you know, I went to you know, the Rijksmuseum and, you know, it, places that you could see incredible art. I can remember graduating from college, at Skidmore College. And my last Christmas, my parents were in Belgium at the time. And so I flew to Antwerp for Christmas vacation. And Dad's big present and surprise for me for my birthday was going to Paris for the first time. So he took me on the train to Paris, and I got to go to the Louvre, which was incredible. Yes. I know. I had been studying art history with my art ed program and all these great paintings for 3 years. And he takes me to the Louvre for my present. So it was really, really amazing. I mean, that's just the way they were. They were curious about a lot of things. And I think that that, you know, has rubbed off on me and how I go about creating projects or trying to understand certain connections and see threads and between things and how they interweave together.
Now, a lot of people may not know this, but you have a twin brother.
That's right. I do have a twin brother. Yep.
And so how was he, through all of this with you? Did he also adopt this whole creative, explorative temperament like you?
He's very entrepreneurial. Yeah. He definitely is very creative and curious. And, you know, he's had several of his own businesses in high school and then went on to work in a wholly completely different field than myself, but he's a very creative individual. And then I also have a younger sister. She's 7 years younger. I have a younger sister. She's seven years younger. And she is the veterinarian at Point Defiance Zoo and Aquarium.
Well, that makes sense. Yeah. Oh, that's just amazing, Kat. I love that story. So you were always drawing, I imagine. You were always had a sketchbook. And we're always drawing, or was there like a moment where you just decided that this was going to become your passion?
I always wanted to be an artist. I mean, my dad had a lot of talent. His sister, who was an art educator, and he would sketch and he would paint. So I can remember, being in Germany, and he had a little studio space when he was not working, had his free time, he'd paint. And that whole thing fascinated me. And I can remember thinking what he was doing was absolutely magical. And I wanted to have a piece of that action, So. And then I think in sixth grade, my grandmother bought me an easel. And that was really wonderful. And she got me, oil pastels. I mean, I always wanted to draw. And then we were living in Turkey, and the arts program there, middle school, high school wasn't very strong. Yeah. So my grandmother had bought me an easel, and that to me was just sort of it's official. This is what I'm really doing, and it was just between my dad's influence and us always going to museums, and he would talk about, what he was seeing and share that with us. My grandmother being very enthusiastic about my art. So that was when I was in sixth grade, then went off to Turkey. And then the arts program there, it wasn't a lot. I mean, we didn't have a lot of time, or we didn't get that in our curriculum as much. So it wasn't really until high school, when I came back to the United States, that I was introduced to a fabulous art educator, and who really changed direction, affirmed that I wanted to go in this direction with my life, was Walter Bartman. And he is the director and founder of the Yellow Barn and Studio in Glen Echo, which is a very highly rated art education place for, adults, children, and so forth, high school. So it's continuing education. And they offer constant studio classes and working with different artists. And I was teaching with them for a while as well. So he really had a huge influence on my life. And then of course, going on to Skidmore, deciding there when I graduated high school that I was gonna be an art educator. And I love that. I mean, they have a very strong art education program there. And the director of the program was Doretta Miller. She was really amazing, and she still is. That combined with the curriculum and the mentor teachers that I was paired with when I was doing my college teaching, and then finding a job in upstate New York and teaching for 9 years. I mean, I really love teaching. I taught middle school.
Well, this is the thing, I just have to get this out, is that I've always seen you as like this, movie star beauty, high class, highly educated, probably the most cultural person in my, friend basket. And then I hear you talk about that, you stayed in a grass hut and used a toilet that was a hole in the ground.
Yep.
And
yep.
I just think how well-rounded you are and how much you, as an educator, can bring to the table for a young person, because you're able to relate on so many different levels.
Right. Right. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. That's really sweet of you. Well, you know, I think it's really important. I mean, like when I met some of the students in middle school, you know, in upstate New York, I was pretty surprised that a few of them had not even been out of the state. So I think as an art educator, you really are bringing a cultural link into the classroom, you know, a historical one, an artistic one, a cultural one. And just, you know, when we did Parents Night, parents would come up to me at the end of the presentation and they would be, wow, art education has really changed since I went to school.
Well,
and that's true.
You're a rare breed, really.
Thank you. It really has changed a lot. There are a lot of requirements, but I think it's important to deliver it in a very interesting and relatable way. And kids are really creative. They love it. And they love having you help them even further their talents and believe in themselves, because at that age, they're really tender and you want them building confidence. You want them seeing possibility and so forth. So yeah, I mean, it was a really wonderful time of my life. And then I went on to teaching adults. So since I've been here in Maryland, I've taught at the Yellow Barn and Studio. I've taught at the Columbia Arts Center. I offer portfolio reviews and I do private lessons through my website. And yes. I have been doing some guest workshops at different venues over the years. I did an entire weekend teaching charcoal at the Palais de Tokyo Museum in Paris, which was incredible. Took a lot of planning going back and forth between Brussels and Paris on the train. I collaborated with their curator of education and also with another friend of mine, Ilka, who had, a real interest in art education and arts. And she's the one that introduced me to their curator. And I really enjoyed it. So I think now when I do any kind of artwork, I think of it as, what is this going to teach? I'm first very passionate about what I'm drawing, but I'm also thinking about how can I use this to further art education for kids or for adults. You know, it's not just making the art for art's sake. It's just admiring a beautiful landscape. It's finding the story within the landscape and also the connections and using that as a educational tool.
So you did this thing. And it was these figures where you painted these figures for International Day of Prayer or something. What was that? What was that? I saw that online.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I was invited by Paul Gordon Chandler to participate in an international exhibit called Amen, a Prayer for the World. And he founded caravan.org, which is an organization that builds bridges, peacekeeping bridges between the religions. He had been doing this and started initially these programs in Cairo, where he was the rector of the Church of Mahdi. And now he is, I believe, in Montana at this point. He's taken several different assignments, but all along he's been developing exhibition opportunities for caravan and for caravan artists. So when I accepted the offer to do this this was in 2014, just before I moved to back here to Washington. I've been living in St. Louis, and he had reached out to me a couple times before when he was in Cairo, but I didn't think I would be able to travel to Cairo. So he did an exhibit that went to London, and then he did this exhibit, which was the second one. And the Amen figures are these very life-sized fiberglass figures that they were created in different positions of prayer. And he said, if you would like to do this, you know, here's an offer to get involved. And I was like, absolutely, this is incredible, because it brings in cultural, it brings in peace building elements to it, and a chance to create something that's really positive. So So I made my figure, painted it in black and white, and I used a lot of my Palouse influence, my years from drawing the Palouse and in and around Spokane, to embellish the outside, you know, the outer part of the figure. So the actual figure itself was designed by Dr. Rita Abdel-Rahman, who's an Egyptian artist of considerable fame, and also one of the people that works consistently with Caravan. And then, so I didn't know at the time it was going to go to the National Cathedral. I just started making the figure. And then next thing you know, within probably several weeks of my working on this piece, he said, we now can announce where these are going. And so the first set started out in Cairo. And so it was at a museum in Cairo. And then the second group, so because this was a continual exhibit that traveled, and it started out with Egyptian artists and then moved to Western artists. And so when the exhibit came to the United States, all the other artists in the Western group had their works shipped to the National Cathedral. So it was there, and they had a wonderful opening with all kinds of international dignitaries and speakers talking about their mission at Caravan. So I actually left you a slide so you could see the beginnings of the piece.
I did see it. At the end of this interview, I will put together a slide presentation and I'll have some of those things in there. But yeah, phenomenal project. And I know it was a real honor for them to have you, and also for you to participate. So what a great collaboration.
Yeah.
Amazing. I would like to look more into that just to see the impact that it's had.
Well, thank you. Yeah. And they continue to have exhibits and calls for artists for different kinds of projects. So anywhere from, submitting videos to paintings and drawings. I mean, this is his passion and pursuit, and it's getting quite a lot of recognition. So, I mean, it's really an amazing organization. So, yeah.
I'll have to put the link somewhere in during your week. I'll put it in on the page so people can learn more. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, through all of this, you've been raising a family. You've got two sons.
Mm-hmm.
So, tell me about them. How old are they? What's their names?
My oldest is Cole. No surprise there. I work in charcoal, right? That was planned. But
interesting.
Yeah.
And your dad was trying to protect you from coal as a child.
it's really funny because I remember when I was in elementary school, it was like, must have been like fourth grade. I remember I was given charcoal pencils to draw with, and I absolutely hated it. It was really, I did not like the experience, and it was really funny. So, it's really ironic that I ended up being an artist that works primarily in charcoal. But anyway, back to my son, Cole. He's a bio engineering student. So, and he is interested in all kinds of things, medicine. He's very curious, interested in micro nanotechnology. He's a senior and we'll be graduating college next year. And then I have a younger son, Dean, who is very creative as well. He takes a little bit more after me in terms of the arts. He likes to draw a lot, but he's also interested in DJing, and he is an avid cook. You've probably seen me post on Facebook, both of my sons. I have them, since we've been in the pandemic, they both have been home. And so they've had a chance to really learn on cooking and various things. And my son, Dean, he's watched a lot of videos cooking. He likes doing that a lot. I'm learning from him. So both really energetic. Of course, juggling as a mom, when they're young, one of the things about working in charcoal is it's a dry medium. So you're not getting up at some critical point in a painting or whatever, something, some other process, and not, and it goes to hell in a handcart, because you had to abandon it for a while. With charcoal, you can come back and forth between it, and nothing happens in the middle. And so whatever you're called to do, at any time. So I would juggle, draw, then be with the kids, and then go back in the evening and draw when they were on naps. I would be drawing, you know, things like that.
Yeah.
It's been really creative here. It's been great. I have enjoyed teaching classes. I've shown some things at the Yellow Barn. I have shown at the Columbia Arts Center. I've taught at the Columbia Arts Center. I really love working with people. A lot of the adult classes, everyone is just so wonderful and interested and kind, and they want to learn. And, you know, I just love it when that light bulb goes off. We're working on a charcoal technique and they're like, oh, that's how that works. And I think it's just, to me, that is just so gratifying to share that information and to help somebody work. And I learn from them as well. You know, I learn a lot from my students. So, you know, it's not just a one-way street, because, you know, we can be in a critique session and have something to talk about that, you know, I hadn't thought about. I'm like, oh, well, you're looking at it this way, I'll look at it that way, but we have this common ground and we're all learning. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it is. Now, how about your online classes? I saw those, and how is that going?
Well, I just started offering them recently within the last week. So, and I've done other workshops too. I did a workshop with Pacific Northwest Art School for a weekend, you know, so doing a weekend workshop with someone when you're on, you know, 8 hours a day with a small group of people is also really interesting and fun. I mean, we all have a good time. We're all there to create and enjoy ourselves and to learn something. So, yeah.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. The Spokane was, you know, the whole area there. I mean, I still come back and forth. So the thing that I want to mention is I've come back every year since I moved away, since 2014. And, you know, I've done that on my own accord. And I've learned a lot from folks that I've met along the way, because, you know, I've always been interested in the Palouse, and a lot of my drawings initially were the Palouse, even though I draw other things. But the agrarian landscape has really been something that has intrigued me. So, you know, trying to learn more, draw historical farms, you know, talking to people, meeting people, you know, and those folks are sharing ideas, and all of a sudden I'm interested in sourdough bread and baking and rare grains and going to conferences. I mean, it just sort of just boom, explodes into this really massive and wonderful learning opportunity. So a lot of creativity comes out of just being curious.
Yeah, and I'm always curious. And as you said, you inherited that.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things where, because I, you know, I'm a landscape painter as well, and I thought my landscapes are more metaphoric and introspective, and you are like actually talking to the farmer and learning the history of the home and the land, and are inspired by all the story behind the landscape. And that is such a different bent from where I come from, that I was just like blown away and has such high respect for you in that regard.
No, thank you.
I think it's super cool. Yeah.
Thank you. I've learned a lot from them. I mean, they're creative people, and they have, you know, Dick and Don Shireman are really good friends of mine. Of course, Don is the owner of the Grain Shed, and Dick and Don also are the co-owners of Palouse Heritage. And they've been absolutely wonderful to friends and to talk to about all kinds of creative things that they're doing with their grains. And, you know, I've learned a lot. I mean, I probably wouldn't have thought of going to a grain conference if I hadn't met them, you know, and because they were so passionate about those things, you know, that, you know, sort of ignited my interest in it. A big shout out to Tom Shireman, who's a good friend of mine. He has done a lot to help get me around and find some unique and interesting places in the Palouse.
It's amazing. And, so generous.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And so it's like, you know, when I go down to that region, it's like it's very familiar now after traveling back since 2014. And it's funny, I didn't meet any of them until I had left and moved to St. Louis. So, I mean, I met Tom through Karen Mobley, and, you know, Tom introduced me to other members of his family, and it just kind of is like snowball from there. And I've learned so much. It's been incredible. So, I love exploring. I mean, I got to tell you, it's not just drawing, it's taking photos too. I mean, I take a ton of photos. So yeah, that's my husband's like, you should offer your photography on your website too. Well, I'm thinking about it because I'm spending at least 50% of my time taking photos, you know?
Right. So yeah. Do you have them in black and white primarily then? You use
actually they're in color. They are in color. Okay. So I do color
photography. I would love to see those. Yeah.
And then I draw in black and white. But you know what? I am adding more color to my portfolio now. So back on the side, I've been exploring color pencils. So I've invested in a ton of color pencils. All kinds of varieties are doing deep introspective hunts on the internet from the top color pencil artists in the world and learning about their techniques. So I've got the equipment and I've been playing around for like the last year and a half and going to be integrating this with the charcoal. So yeah.
Well, was there something else that you wanted to just toss into the mix as far as what's going on with you and where you're going, what you're working on now, what you're going to be working on soon?
Well, I mean, I'm always like digging up new ideas, you know, and every time I take a trip back out west, I end up seeing a lot of new and cool imagery. I've been over some of the same landscapes year after year after year, and I always see it through a new lens. I mean, because it's evolving and it's changing. I'm real interested in some of the landscapes here as well. I mean, I love the Chesapeake, as you may have seen. I spend some time on the water, both sailing and fishing. My husband's very into fishing. So, and I was fishing a lot when I was a kid with my twins. So the Chesapeake and some of the environmental issues around that are an interesting subject for me. I've got huge striper fish last season, Catfish Bay, catfish, just being out there in the water. And, you know, there's been times I've been under the bridge where it's like kind of foggy and the landscape is really interesting. You get out there on the boat and sometimes it's, calm, and other times it's a little bit more rough. And every time I'm out there, I'm with my camera taking pictures. So I guess you could expect to see some Chesapeake pieces.
Okay. Well, that sounds awesome.